Hello, everybody. Welcome to the newsroom of the Chicago Tribune. It's Tuesday. It's your culture lunch featuring Mark Caro in a diesel shirt, vintage diesel shirt. Tribune entertainment reporter Mark Caro and the fabulous, the one, the only Nina Metz.
Hi.
Tribune entertainment reporter. So the man they call the Dickens of Detroit has died, Elmore Leonard. Leonard, the crime novelist, author of Get Shorty and Freaky Deaky, was 87. And he stayed in Michigan. He had his chances to go to the coast, but he never did. And his writing, which has been discussed a lot today, elevated the status of so-called genre writing. This was a guy who didn't pen pulp fiction, but was like a great writer. So
yes.
Were you a big fan?
Yeah, I really liked his books. And I liked particularly a lot of the adaptations of his books into films, and certainly the TV show Justified. He sort of had a spotty record, and he would say this. I interviewed him last year for a
piece. You were one of the last people, yeah, I know you're the last person in this building to interview him, certainly.
Possibly.
Yeah.
I talked to him last year for a piece I wrote about TV shows adapted from books. And he was pretty honest about how, like, I think he hated 70% of the adaptations. There have been a lot, by the way, like maybe 30, 40 films have been made.
Because he was a prolific writer, obviously.
He was.
And he supposedly he sat there all day, right, and wrote, just like you, Mark Harry, just
exactly.
Wrote constantly from 10 to 6 in the day.
Well, it's a tribute to the fact that he came up with good plots and that there are so many movies that actually worked from his books. I mean, you look at someone like, I mean, this is a different genre, but someone like Robert Ludlum, I mean, they just can't do it. And even when they do something like Bourne Identity, they have to kind of tear it apart just to make it work. Whereas he, I mean, someone like something like Out of Sight, which is a fantastic movie. I mean, I think a lot of people are going to remember him for these movies made out of his books, which probably drives him crazy because movies have such a greater reach.
Yeah.
Yet at the same time, he was really like this writer's writer, where he had all these rules, and people were like, yeah, he says, you know, just you said, don't say confirmed or replied, or just you said, never write the word suddenly, and leave out the parts that you as a reader don't want to read. And you know, if it's and what's his line is
never describe the weather.
Yeah, don't open describing the weather. And if it sounds like writing, I rewrite it. You know, that's just like a boom. Like, and that's a great, and that's a great. These are great pieces of advice.
So,
I think
this is kind of a populist. I mean, what do you think?
Damon Runyon. Do you know what I mean? There's like a certain like a colloquial way his characters would talk, the dialogue. I think that was really would grab your eye or your ear. You know what I mean? When I did speak to him, what I loved about it was that he was completely anti-technology, and when I spoke to him, he's like, I don't have email, I don't want to get anything that way, it's all sort of meaningless anyway, I'm much happier without it. He would write out his books longhand, and then type them up into a manuscript. So I thought that was kind of great. He kind of like did his own thing in the suburbs of Detroit.
Where there aren't that many famous writers, it has to be said.
I mean, the Jal Blum.
Yeah.
I mean, that's the great thing about being a novelist.
I say again,
right?
There aren't that many
novelists
famous writers.
Novelists can sort of live anywhere, and it doesn't matter. And certainly he, you know, rose to prominence at a time when there probably wasn't as much pressure maybe for him to move, don't you think?
Well, he obviously didn't give a darn, right? He just preferred to, just did what he did.
Yeah.
You know?
And he had these crime novels, but they had this like element of wit in them. And there are other writers like Carl Hiaasen who you'd say were sort of in that vein, but they sort of hit the humor harder and a little bit clunkier sometimes.
You know, Pynchon kind of has that similar,
don't you think?
Just a fun read.
Well, he made headlines today in his death, for sure. This weekend, I was in Wisconsin, and I was handed this flyer for a drive-in movie theater there just outside Spring Green with a big problem that Illinois drive-ins have been facing too, which is the need to upgrade the equipment to digital technology since movies are not likely to be distributed on film for much longer. And this was kind of a sad, it was kind of a sad flyer, frankly. They were selling t-shirts and hot dogs, and it was like they were just trying to raise $70,000, which when you think about it, you know, new building campaigns are often $400 million.
Yeah.
Here was this little drive-in trying to raise $70,000 so they could get
That's a lot of money for a business that only runs, what, 6 months less out of the year.
I mean, if I had $70,000, I would have just said, go get your digital projector.
When was the last time you went to a drive-in?
The rest of my family did. I picked them up afterwards.
Why didn't you go?
Because I was at a show, you know, had to work. But everybody was there, and everybody had a good time. You know, no more speakers on the car windows. It's all, of course, through the radio now. But it was a great little drive-in. So
was it a first run?
First run, and it was packed out. But, you know, if they don't get digital technology, so I guess now everything, you know, they have no choice.
Well, the reason they need to switch to digital is that studios simply are not making prints anymore. Everything comes in like on a thumb drive.
Right.
So, I mean, it's sort of for practical reasons. I guess they could screen older films, but if you want to be a first run, drive-in.
It's sort of funny to me how so much of the arts are nonprofit, and then they have these huge fundraising arms, right? And then a great little thing like a drive-in, because it's a for-profit business, you know, some little entrepreneur not making much money, it's actually harder, you know, they can't get $70,000 for the projector, you
right.
know? Because there's no way to make that kind of money to put into it.
Yeah, I mean, a drive-in is an interesting thing, because if you were sort of starting from scratch, like if there were no drive-ins, would you invent a drive-in now? Or is a drive-in just something that kind of harks you back to another time? Because, like, really, like, there's so many more ways we see movies now than we did when drive-ins were invented. I mean, if you're in a car, you're not interacting with other people like you are in an audience of a theater.
Right.
So it's still an isolated experience. Like, you could have that in your
But
living
in your
room.
Youth, you may well have wanted an isolated experience, Mark.
Well, there's
you may
there's,
have wanted
there's,
a little privacy
there's
in your, a,
right,
in there's
your
Chevy.
Right,
as you
right well,
there.
That's sort of the
Making
old,
out
you know, exactly.
The
so, you're, so then really it doesn't matter what the sound quality is, if it's digital or
but
not.
But you got to have a projector.
Before we move on, I just want to mention, so locally here,
yeah.
The McHenry Outdoor Theater is going to have next weekend, August 30th and 31st, Rusty Nails, who's sort of a local curator of horror films,
right.
is going to do one of these. He's called them, they're called Terror in the Isles. This one's going to be called Drive-In Massacre. And so he sort of compiles all these old horror films, campy horror films, usually brings in an old movie star or something like that. He does old trailers. So he's going to do that. In 2 weeks. 2 weeks? Yeah, 2 weeks. August 30th and 31st.
All right, so let's hope they get it.
To raise money for them.
For the digital projector. Well, let's hope they get it.
Should I say where you can go?
Sure.
GoldenAgeCinemas.com is the McHenry Outdoor
All right,
theater.
Well, we wish them well with their projectors. So there's this fascinating article in Salon Magazine recently about how, this is all about how Google is rotting our brains. Yes, not the culture lunch. Google, rotting your brains. Because the search engine doesn't really provide you with knowledge, the premise of the article is, but is actually relying on other searches to answer your search. With me? So what that means is a lot of nonsense can rise to the top of your search results. So, Mark Caro, Googler.
Yes?
Is it rotting your brain?
I don't know. These sort of big pronouncements, if you sort of scroll down on that article on there, you'll see a toilet. And this guy was like looking up stuff about how much time people spend on the toilet and was finding like, you know, wiki answers and other sort of forms.
10 minutes, 45
minutes a day or something like that. And you know, I suppose that with Sudoku, without Sudoku, it makes a difference, I suppose. But with your iPad, with your iPhone. But he was sort of like complaining that you get all this sort of wrong information when you ask a question like that. I'm like, well, of course you do. You know, if you go on, but if you're actually using it as a library, then, you know, you're going to find some stuff or not. I mean, the thing that was interesting about that article was that idea of it's rewiring your brain because you just sort of, instead of retaining knowledge, you figure you can find it.
Right.
And that's, and you know, it's I was interviewing, Peter Orner for at Litfest, and I was asking, I think it was he and Adam Levin, and I think that Adam was sort of saying that he sort of really, you know, you appreciates Google because you can get details. And Peter was saying, you know, I never use it because I just want to be everywhere that I'm writing about and I don't want to sort of fall back on that. And so, like, as a writer, it's an interesting question. You know, if you're
Google
trying to
Nina?
Soak up absence here.
I mean, that's sort of a rhetorical question, right?
But there is this point, right, that Google's algorithms involve popularity of search. So the idea of looking for information does become part of the generation of information. Very different from, you know, 50 years ago where there would be a source of information.
Right,
and
but
how
he's,
you
but
were looking
assuming,
for it wouldn't
But he's
matter.
Assuming in this article that you're just going to go to the top thing that's there instead of, like, looking and going, okay, this is a good source, this is not a good source, this is the Joe blog giving this versus this is Time Magazine
right.
or Encyclopedia
right.
Britannica or
I don't know,
whatever.
These days, do people really notice the sources on Google? I mean, are people that careful
you
anymore?
You can tell.
Yeah, I don't know.
That's
don't
up
know.
To you, though. It's like know. Going
well,
to the library.
Our brains are rotted. Our brains are rotted. Another
what do you
new
think,
trend.
Nina? No,
brain
seriously.
Is too rotted to answer. So, listen, another new trend, as reported by Steve Johnson in the Chicago Tribune, the ability to wear headphones at a concert for a price, at the concession stand kind of thing, and then take a perfect mix directly from the soundboard. Got it? So you go to a concert, you put on your plug-in to the board itself, and then you have the perfect sound mix. I mean, why not stay home if you're going to do that? Like, you, is that really, you want to do that? You want to put these big headphones on and isolate you? Isn't a crappy sound mix part of the
But if you're sitting in a car, it would have been okay. If you're sitting in a car, it would be like, oh, this is great. But if you're just like wearing headphones, it ruins everything.
Well, we've talked about sort of these outdoor festival concerts where a lot of people get fed up with everyone around them is talking too loudly during certain shows.
So, the purists.
So this would solve that issue, I suppose. You know what I think about? You know when you go see like a stand-up comedian at the Chicago Theater and they have a big video screen? Because if you're sitting way up in the back, you really can't see the person that well. And so by default, you end up watching them on video. And I'm always like, this is surreal. I'm here in person watching this comedian on stage, but your eye's always drawn to the video. So it does feel like there's this weird remove. What's the difference?
So Mark Carroll, you were at Paul McCartney not long ago in Milwaukee. Had there been on offer a pair of headphones, direct mix into the Paul McCartney soundboard, so let's call it $10, would you have done it?
I might have done it out of curiosity. And it's funny, because when I go to a concert, like a loud concert, I typically take earplugs, and I stuff them in, like the silicone stuff.
Like the old man
I stuff them in there because when I was covering music, I just realized I was blasting my ears apart.
Right.
So I don't want to have tinnitus, so it's important to do that. So in a sense, I'm already kind of sort of messing with it, but there's something about the shared experience again, and also the visceral. See, it's interesting because when I listen to music in general, it's very different when you listen to an album on headphones than when you blast it out of your stereo. And I still am a believer in blasting out of your stereo, except everyone in my house doesn't want me to.
What's the difference?
What is the difference?
It's just more. There's a visceral impact of music coming out of speakers that you don't have.
Even when your headphones are turned on.
Headphones,
you get a lot of more detail too. I'm not even saying it's necessarily worse. I'm just saying it's different.
You prefer headphones?
But if you had headphones on at a concert, you'd still have that blast of the bass. So maybe that would be cool. But the idea of having a bunch of people with headphones, it just seems off-putting.
You know, you prefer headphones?
At a concert?
Anywhere. You blast out of your stereo?
No, my point being, blasting out of your stereo, it gets like lost in sort of the acoustics of the room versus headphones, especially the kind most of us wear. They're like in your ear.
Yeah.
No, I mean, it's like the sound is in your head. I think that's much more sort of in that look on your face.
So after Google rots your brains, you just kind of input the sound.
See, and I don't even get earbuds. I have like these ones that sit on there because I don't like it. I don't like that. I don't know.
Well, don't watch the Culture Lunch in headphones because we're much better directly.
You can watch it in headphones because your computer has bad speakers, so you should watch the Culture Lunch in headphones.
Well, lastly, a new enterprise at the Theatre Loop, an in-performance series of videos. Yes, indeedy. The glories just keep on coming. So we'll leave you today with Pigpen, a music theater group performing a number from The Old Man and the Sea at Riders Theater in Chicago. For Nina Metz, Mark Carroll, I'm Chris Jones. Thank you for coming. I saw your reflection.
And you wish a million. There you